for the welfare of the whole humanity. Shanti Shanti Hari Om Tat Sat. Stavakaya cha dharmasya sarvadharma swarupine Stavakaya cha dharmasya sarvadharma swarupine avatar varishtha Ramakrishnaya te namah Asato ma sadgamaya Tamaso ma jyotirgamaya Mrityorma mritang Shanti Shanti. Let us bow down to Sri Ramakrishna, the embodiment of all religions, the Supreme Incarnate. Let us pray to him to lead us from the darkness of ignorance to the light of knowledge, to lead us from unreal to the real, to lead us from death to immortality. We are just dwelling upon Sri Ramakrishna's teachings taken from the Gospel. In the last 2-3 classes, I am speaking about how one should go towards God, and the same topic I am continuing today. Spiritual life begins only when you are set in that direction. As has been said many times, your spiritual life depends upon your spiritual goal. Have you set your goal? Without that, no spiritual life. Because everything should be different. It should be specific. You must be very clear about what you are doing. And so Sri Ramakrishna is very particular about knowing the things very clearly and following the instructions properly. So here Sri Ramakrishna tells, remember always that the goal of life is realization of God and that a life without God is a zero. That means life not associated with God is meaningless life. meaningless, worthless. So here, it's very important for you to know whether you have set your goal in your life. If you have set the goal, then it follows that you should follow some disciplines in order to reach the goal. And as I have said many times before, many, many paths are leading towards the spiritual goal. Paths are many. You don't have to bother about the paths. Paths are open in front of you. They are there. You have to choose and go. That is needed. Choosing and then going. That is action. You must act in such a way that you must realize your goal and you are struggling sincerely towards achieving that goal. So Sri Ramakrishna tells very, very clearly, remember always that the goal of life is realization of God, and that a life without God is a zero. Realization of God means you must see God face to face and talk to Him. It is no more a myth, it is a reality, and you became aware of that reality. And it is possible to realize God in this human life. What is needed is you have to direct your body and mind and all your resources in that direction. And Sri Ramakrishna himself has set a model. He himself set the goal. He wanted to realize God. He wanted nothing else. And wholeheartedly, he devoted himself in spiritual practices and he realized the truth. So, remember always that the goal of life is realization of God and that a life without God is a zero. So, not to realize God, you have to cherish love towards God. That's important. The goal of human life is to love God and cultivate this love so as to realize Him. So use that faculty of love towards God. One is born in this world for this purpose. But people have lost the vision of this purpose and they are moving purposelessly. If you are living the life without your aspiration to see God, you are living a futile life, a purposeless life, which means the whole life is wasted. For attaining this goal, you must always be aware of it. Every day you must visualize your goal. That's why we keep telling the aspirants, are you doing practices properly? Unless you pray to God, unless you call on Him, you will not become aware of the goal. You will just forget the goal. You forget it totally. Because the opposite forces are so great and so powerful, they just drag you in your weak moments and just push you towards ruin. So, this constant awareness of God is very important to march in your spiritual life. So, to be always aware of the goal, you must always think of God. All our thoughts, all our actions should be attuned towards achieving this aim of life, namely God realization. It is not simply to talk about. You have to practice it. You have to realize it. That's what Sri Ramakrishna wanted. If you are the disciple of Sri Ramakrishna, if you follow his teachings, your first and foremost priority should be to realize God in this human life. And you must constantly remember Him so that you are always aware of your goal. You are not lost in this world. So all your actions and thoughts must be properly regulated in the spiritual direction. Any thought or any action which diverts your mind away from the path towards God should be shunned, should be rejected totally. Spiritual life is a very serious life in the sense there is no room for making jokes or fun in the spiritual matters. A life without God in it is a zero, as I said in the beginning. Life without God is a zero. Put any number of zeros one after the other, what's the value? It is still zero. Zero after zero, zero multiplied by zero equals zero only. But when you put a one at the left end, all the zeros become valuable. These are the words of Sri Ramakrishna. So you have to put one, which is very important. That one is God. You may achieve or acquire many worldly things of pleasure. You may acquire immense power, position, name, fame. They are all worthless if not done in the name of God and for reaching Him ultimately. It is simply trash. A life without God will be like a lamp without no oil, with no oil. A life without God will be like a lamp with no oil. Such a lamp will be dim and such a life will be gloomy and miserable. As oil in the lamp brightens it up, love for God will be brightened up. It brightens the life. But most of the mortals who come to the world are bound souls. They are chained by fetters. And they are oblivious of this supreme aim of life. Sri Ramakrishna gives a graphic picture of the bound souls and their repulsion to spirituality. The people in the world whose mind is totally towards the world, towards enjoyment, towards pleasures, towards everything about the world, they are tied to the world by the fetters of lust and gold, that is lust and greed. They consider these as the world and regard money as their lifeblood. So people slave for their masters to earn food for themselves and their families, and they earn money by lying, they earn money by cheating, they earn money by flattery. Asha apashatair baddhaha kamakrodha parayanaha ihante kamabhogartam anyayena artha sanchayan. Lord Krishna says in the Gita, in order to satisfy his unending desires, he begins to earn money by improper means. They may even laugh at those who think of God, who meditate on Him, and they call the people who think and meditate on God as lunatics. The bound creatures are under the impression that lust and gold will make them happy and give them security. They don't realize that they, on the other hand, will lead them to annihilation. The false security of the material world is illustrated by a few examples. Sri Ramakrishna tells, when a net is cast into the lake to catch the fish, some are never caught, but most of them are entangled in the net. Some try to free themselves out of it. A few may jump out, but most of them cannot escape, nor do they make any attempt to get out. They burrow into the mud and lie there quietly, thinking, we need not fear anymore. We are quite safe here. But the poor things do not know that the fisherman will drag them out with the net a few minutes later. The worldly people are like these fishes. They are also like the silkworm, which winds a silk cocoon around it and gets itself imprisoned within it. And even though it can come out of it, wants to remain within, and there it is killed. Another example of a bound existence is that of the fish which gets into the fish trap kept in the bunds of paddy fields. It can come out by the way it has entered, but it sports inside the trap with other fish and hears the sweet sound of murmuring water and forgets everything else. It doesn't even make an attempt to free itself from the trap. It thinks it is quite okay for it to stay there. There is no difficulty or danger. That is the fate of the worldly people. It is difficult for the bound creatures, entangled in worldliness, to come to their senses, even if they suffer unending misery and agony and face much dangers, even then. They may not awaken themselves. The more it eats, Sri Ramakrishna gives the example of camel. These worldly people are like the camel, which likes to eat thorny bushes. The more it eats thorns, the more is the blood which gushes forth from its mouth. Still it cannot give up eating them. The same way, the man who is totally entangled in the world, he may suffer much sorrow due to various difficulties, afflictions, but he forgets all in a few days and begins his old life all over again. For instance, a person loses his wife, but after some time he marries again. A son dies and the mother suffers bitter grief. A few days later, she forgets all this, attends to her toilet and puts on her jewelry. A father becomes a bankrupt by the marriage of his daughters by paying huge dowry, yet he goes on having children year after year. No family planning. Because no people are doing family planning. But not for spiritual purpose. Just to enjoy themselves more with less botheration. So such people never think of God, and if they get any leisure, what do? They indulge in idle gossip, chatting. And they engage themselves in foolish talk, or they engage in fruitless work. When time hangs heavy on their heads, they perhaps start playing cards. The spiritual consciousness of such people is not at all awakened, even though they hear about God 1,000 times. But simply it's a word without any meaning, without any significance. People, I hear many times, often people keep on saying, oh God, like that. It means nothing. They are like crocodiles on whose hide you cannot make any impression with a sword. You can't drive a nail into a stone, and they are like that. Even if under some circumstances longing for God comes to a worldly minded soul, it will be only a momentary, like a drop of water on a red hot frying pan. The water hisses and dries up in an instant. Once the yearning for God realization comes to the bound soul, then he is saved. The real security starts when he comes towards God, not when he goes away from God. There was a guy I read in the Chicago Tribune, probably 2 months back, one of the richest person in the world. He had security guards, so many people were there. But still, some miscreant entered and killed him. Richest man. What kind of security it is that? It is. This comes when he is finished with his enjoyments and duties. As long as his mind is hankering after sensual pleasures, he can't turn his back towards God. He can't turn back to God. In fact, it is so very interesting for me to observe. It's a remarkable observation, and even now it is so clear to my mind. There was a devotee coming to ashram, here I'm talking about, for many, many years. Very devoted, initiated disciple, coming for a long time, means many years. He had a wife, but at some point of time he had divorced that wife, or wife might have divorced him, whatever it is. He was living all alone. But then one day we heard that that person was in love with some lady, and there is every possibility that he might marry her. The next time I heard was, he married. From that day, he chose that lady. From that day, he began to live with that lady. From that day onwards, till today, I have not seen him. And somebody, very close friend, that friend used to come very regularly, attends all of our Sunday services. I asked, what happened to that person? I am not seeing. Oh, Swami, don't you know? He has got a partner now. And it is not the criticism of the woman. Never think like that. I am telling the desire to enjoy, the desire to have the pleasure. That was more prominent. So that was so prominent, other things were insipid. And that's how the world pulls you and throws you, not simply pulling. It grabs you and throws you. That's the way how the world does. So, yearning for God relation comes only when a person's desire for enjoying is finished. Then he comes to know that the important thing is somehow to cultivate devotion to God and love for Him. Then he begins to lose interest in worldly things and tries to attune his life in such a way that it leads him to the ultimate reality. Sri Ramakrishna tells that blessed indeed is the householder who performs his duties in the world, at the same time cherishing love for the lotus feet of the Lord. He is indeed a hero He is like one who strives for God realization while carrying a heavy load on his head. It may appear to be extremely difficult, but is there anything, however hard, that cannot be achieved through God's grace? God's grace makes even the impossible possible. So, set the goal. The goal of life is realization of God. Become aware of it constantly by thinking of God constantly. Cherish love towards Him. Cultivate love towards Him. Then it will be possible for you to go in the spiritual path. So that is the instruction which Sri Ramakrishna gave. Remember always that the goal of life is realization of God, and that a life without God is a zero. Now the next point Sri Ramakrishna tells. So, if you have set God realization as your goal, Sri Ramakrishna is stressing another important factor. Let God be first and then the world. Fix your mind on God and live in this world. Fix your mind in God and then live in this world. You are free from dangers. Knowing that God realization is the supreme aim of life, you have to work towards achieving it. That means you have to give God the prime place in your life, and all the rest only next to Him. Prime place in the life. We have to fix our mind on God with constant remembrance and by not forgetting Him even once. This has to be done while living in this world. In the world there are many forces which oppose or neutralize your efforts for God realization. These are cravings for worldly pleasures. And the forces such as lust, anger, greed, infatuation, egotism and envy, which vitiate your mind and divert it from the path of God. If you are in the grip of these, lust, anger, infatuation, greed, then the mind cannot go towards God. So, you have to get yourself fortified against the obstacles. How? By cultivating love for God and acquiring knowledge and realization. So our first concern should be God, getting love for Him, His realization, His knowledge, His blessings, and our union with Him. Once we develop love of God, once we develop bhakti for Him, we can lead the life of a householder without the risk of getting entangled in worldly things. Sri Ramakrishna illustrates this with various examples. If you smear oil on your hand and cut a jackfruit, the sticky fluid will not stick to your hand. So, first secure the oil of divine love and then set your hands on the duties of the world. So let us try to be aware of our goal. Let us always think of God. Let us give foremost place for God in our life. All our thoughts and actions must be done directed towards God. With God, your life becomes blessed. Without God, your life becomes useless. Now, I shall read some passage. Page 640, Master said smilingly, "How much attention do you give to the world? 50%? Laughter. Host said, "You know that, sir, we can't achieve anything without the grace of holy person like yourself." Master, "If you please God, everyone will be pleased. It is God alone that exists in the heart of the holy man." Host said, "Nothing, of course, remains unrealized when one attains God. If a man attains God, he can give up everything else. If a man gets a rupee, he gives up the joy of a penny." It is true. Sri Ramakrishna himself has said, and all the holy people have said, once you have the vision of God, once you get the joy of communication with God, all the worldly joys put together are just insignificant. The joy of seeing God is unparalleled. And it is very uplifting joy. Master said, "A little spiritual discipline is necessary. Through the practice of discipline, one gradually obtains divine joy. Suppose a jar with money inside is hidden deep under the earth and someone wants to possess it. In that case, he must take the trouble of digging for it. As he digs, he perspires. After much digging, the spade strikes the metal jar. He feels a thrill at the sound. The more sound the spade makes striking against the jar, the more joy he feels. Pray to Rama. Meditate on him. He will certainly provide you with everything." Host said, "Revered sir, you are Rama himself." Master replied, "How is that?" "The waves belong to the river. Does the river belong to the waves?" Host said, "Rama dwells only in the hearts of holy men. He can't be seen in any other way. There is no incarnation of God at the present time." Master smilingly said, "How do you know there is no divine incarnation?" The host remained silent. Master said, "All cannot recognize an incarnation. When Narada visited Rama, Rama prostrated himself before Narada and said, 'We are worldly creatures. How can we be sanctified unless holy men like you visit us?' Further, Rama went into exile in the forest to redeem his father's pledges. He saw that since hearing of his exile, the rishis of the forest had been fasting. Many of them did not know that Rama was none other than the Supreme Brahman." Host said, "You two are that same Rama." Masters replied, "For heaven's sake, never say that." As Sri Ramakrishna spoke these words, he bowed down to the host and said with folded hands, "That Rama dwells in all beings. He exists everywhere in the universe. I am your servant. It is Rama himself who has become all men, animals and other living beings." Host said, "But sir, we do not know that." Master replied, "Whether you know it or not, you are Rama." Host said, "You are free from love and hatred." Master said, "How so?" "I engaged a carriage to bring me to Calcutta and advanced the coachman 3 annas, but he did not turn up. I became very angry with him. He is a very wicked man. He made me suffer a lot." Sri Ramakrishna was resting. The Marwari devotees had been singing bhajan on the roof. They were celebrating the Krishna festival. Arrangements had been made for worship and food offering. At the host's request, the master went to see the image. He bowed down before the deity. I shall stop here. Any questions? Repeat again. All the negative ideas, negative forces must be removed. There is no time. And you should not allow all other things to come up in your way of thinking God. When you think of God, God will take care of everything else. So, grudges or vengeance, they're all like poison. And they make people more and more commit crimes, more and more violence. And consequently, they will be led to more suffering. So coming to God means it's a new life. Absolutely new life. And a new life must be started with freshness. Forget about all other things. Forget totally. Use that quality of forgetfulness in this way. All these are very good. Forgetfulness is good in a way, but forget all the bad things. Remember the good things. If you try to concentrate and focus more and more on God, the rest of the things will adjust accordingly. Constant remembrance of God will take care of everything. That's why we keep on telling, do japa, do japa, do japa. All the time, mentally. And during fixed time. At all the times. As many times as possible. So don't always hold on to the minimum. Oh, my guru has said 108 times that I have done. It's all right, you have done. You have kept the lamp burning, that's all. But if you want to have the glory of lamp, you must give more oil and see that you see the bright light. Anyway, how much more your mind can go towards God is important. How much mind is going towards world, how much mind is coming towards God, that you have to judge. You yourself involve in activities, and so you have to reap the reactions of those activities in whatever the reactions they may come. You can't deny it. Oh, why it has come? Why it has come? Because you have done, so it has come. So, keep doing good things. Always remember God, whatever you do. So, follow some values in the life. be aware of our spiritual reality and know the nature of this world and the people in the world ordinarily, how they behave. It doesn't mean that all the people are like that, so I should also be like that. That's a foolish argument. If all the people take filth, it doesn't mean you should also go and take filth. It doesn't mean that. You be wise first. Otherwise, as Sri Ramakrishna said, you'll be just drowned in the world. That means you'll be drowned in the worldly ways of the world. That means you'll be far, far, far away from God. You'll be always under some kind of suffering, unhappiness, all sorts of things. So that is the gist of my talk. We'll stop here. Chant the name of the Lord and His glory unceasingly, that the mirror of the heart may be wiped clean and quench that mighty forest fire, worldly lust, raging furiously within, whose name streamed down in moonlight on the lotus heart, opening its cup to knowledge of thyself, O Self, drowned deep in the waves of His bliss, tasting His nectar at every step, bathing in His name that bath fair weary souls. Various are thy names, O Lord, in each and every name thy power resides. No times are set, no rites are needful for chanting of thy name. So vast is thy mercy, how huge then is my wretchedness, who find in this empty life and heart no devotion to thy name. O my mind, be humbler than a blade of grass. Be patient and forbearing like a tree. Take no honor to thyself, give honor to all. Chant unceasingly the name of the Lord. O Lord and soul of the universe, mine is no prayer for wealth or retinue, the playthings of lust or the toys of fame. As many times as I may be reborn, grant me, O Lord, a steadfast love for Thee. A drowning man in this world's fearful ocean is Thy servant, O sweet one. In Thy mercy, consider him as dust beneath Thy feet. Ah, how I long for the day when an instant separation from Thee, O Lord, will be as a thousand years, when my heart burns away with its desire, and the world without Thee is a heartless void. Prostrate at Thy feet, let me be in unwavering devotion, neither imploring the embrace of Thine arms, nor bewailing the withdrawal of Thy presence, though it tears my soul asunder. O Thou who stealest the hearts of Thy devotees, do with me what Thou wilt, for Thou art my heart's beloved, Thou and Thou alone. O Lord, lead us from the unreal to the real, lead us from darkness to light, and lead us from death to immortality. May all be free from dangers, may all realize what is good, may all be actuated by noble thoughts, may all rejoice everywhere. May all be happy, may all be free from disease, may all realize what is good, may none be subject to misery. May the wicked become virtuous, may the virtuous reign tranquility, may the tranquil be free from bonds, may the freed make others free. May good betide all people, may the sovereign righteously rule the earth, may all beings ever attain what is good, may the worlds be prosperous and happy. May the clouds pour rain in time, may the earth be blessed with crops, may all countries be freed from calamity, may holy men live without fear. May the Lord, the destroyer of sins, the presiding deity of all sacred works, be satisfied. For He being pleased, the whole universe becomes pleased. He being satisfied, the whole universe feels satisfied.